Just 10 seconds more.
So I think we'll ask Dr. Raju to start it.
Yeah, please.
Dr. Raju can start the introduction. And
yes. Vijay, Raju, kya khabar sab theek hai, Vijay bhai?
Yeah. Shall I start?
Yes, sir. Please. I think you should start, sir. Please.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for joining us on the second webinar on the publication-related presentation. So I'll be presenting my early experience of arthroscopic assisted ankle arthrodesis, which was a retrospective study of 32 cases, which we published in the JCOD journal in about 4 years ago in 2016. Ankle arthrodesis, as you know, is a challenging operation. And until recent past, most of these surgeries were done by open techniques, but with variable and unpredictable results. And various approaches used for ankle arthrodesis included anterior, transmalleolar, and posterior approaches with various types of fixation methods used, like an external fixator of Chandler type, large cancellous.
Sir, your screen is not visible.
You have to share the screen, sir.
You have to share the screen, sir.
Is it not visible?
No, sir. You share your screen. It is not visible.
So how do I do it?
So you go down. There is a green button. Share screen.
Just a moment. I am sorry.
No worries.
Share the
share screen.
Yes. And then what do I do?
And then your screen will come to us, and then you can start your presentation. But it's not yet shared.
Share the screen then. Okay. It says share.
Yeah. Now. Yeah. So now your screen share is started, sir. Now you run your presentation.
Okay. Okay. I am sorry. I'll start again.
No, you're no worries, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, that's perfect, sir. Thank you.
So, welcome to this webinar. I'll be presenting our initial experience of arthroscopic assisted ankle arthrodesis, which was a retrospective study of 32 cases, which was published in the Journal of Clinical Orthopedics and Trauma 2016. As you know, ankle arthrodesis is often a challenging surgery until recently, and this was performed using various open techniques, but with variable results, which were unpredictable also. Various approaches were used for ankle arthrodesis, included anterior, transmalleolar, and posterior approaches, and various fixation methods that were used were compression with external fixator, large cancellous screw, or sometimes intramedullary fixations. Whichever technique you use, whether arthroscopic or open, the basic principles are to create a broad, flat cancellous surfaces that are placed in a position to allow fusion to occur at the tibio-patellar joint. Arthrodesis site should then be stabilized with a rigid internal fixation, or if possible, with an external fixation. Achieving this in an osteoporotic patient with conventional implants may be difficult. And another important thing to keep in mind is that hind foot should be aligned to the leg and the forefoot to the hind foot to create a plantigrade situation of the foot, which helps in patients walking normally. So we collected 32 consecutive patients retrospectively in our hospital at Indraprastha Apollo Hospital from 2008 to 2015. Out of these, 4 patients were excluded due to incomplete and mandatory follow-up of 1 year. So the main indication was post-traumatic arthritis in about 2/3 of the patient. Remaining 1/3 had primary OA, inflammatory arthropathy, and avascular necrosis in one case. The procedure involved supine position on a conventional surgical table. We did not use any joint distraction technique in any of these cases except for fluid irrigation under pressure, a pneumatic tourniquet was used during the procedure in all the patients. The anatomical landmarks of the ankle were identified and marked with a pen. The average tourniquet time was initially 70 minutes, which has now reduced to around 40 to 45 minutes. And the mean hospital stay in this series were 2 days, ranging from 1 to 4 days. We used the normally used arthroscope of 4 millimeter, 30 degrees. Arthroscopic portals used were antrolateral and antromedial. The antromedial portal was first made using a trocar and cannula, and the arthroscope was then inserted. The antrolateral portal was then created under direct vision by entering an intravenous needle lateral to the extensor digitorum tendon. The joint was kept distended with normal saline under pressure with pressure bag. Remaining articular cartilage of that arthritic joint was shaved using arthroscopic 5mm shaver and burr. The underlying eburnated subchondral bone was then roughened until the bleeding surface was achieved using arthroscopic burr, as you can see in one of these pictures in the last. The freshening of the joint surfaces of the ankle was assessed by image intensifier intraoperatively. And we preferred the position of for arthrodesis in most cases in neutral dorsiflexion, 5 to 10 degrees of external rotation, and 0 to 5 degrees of valgus of the ankle joint. The fixation of the arthrodesis was done using two 16 mm cancellous screw, 7 millimeter in diameter, after putting a guide wire crossing the tibio-talar joint, as shown in this image intensifier view, in a crisscross fashion. Here is an example of one of the cases with primary osteoarthritis of the ankle joint in advanced stage. This was fixed using two crossed 7 mm 16 millimeter thread cancellous screw using arthroscopic assisted arthrodesis. And this is a 6 months post-surgery x-ray showing a very sound arthrodesis achieved in this patient. The patients were immobilized for 2 weeks in a below knee slab. And after a stitch removal, the full below knee cast was applied for another 6 weeks, making it for about 8 weeks in total. Partial weight bearing was allowed for 6 weeks, and full weight bearing then gradually started after 8 weeks. And a short course of physiotherapy was required, especially in elderly patients, to regain movements of the foot and proprioception. The mean age of our patient was 43.7 with 20 to 76 years range. Average post-operative duration of symptoms was more than 1 year in almost all patients. The follow-up was minimum of 1 year with a mean of 1.7 years. And average time to union was 14 weeks in this series. And arthrodesis was achieved in all the cases with no cases of pseudoarthrosis. 4 patients had minor complications in the form of prominent hardware requiring screw removal after the fusion of ankle arthrodesis. 1 patient also had superficial infection at the screw site, which was managed conservatively. We assessed our patients at 1 year. There were good to excellent outcomes in about 85% of the patients, with fair to poor outcome in about 15% of the patient. And we used Carlson-Peterson scoring system. The preoperative score was 32.7, and postoperatively at 3 months was 74, and at 12 months were 89, which were pretty good. So friends, arthroscopic assisted ankle arthrodesis, when we started, was a very new procedure, and we hardly had much experience to share with or available in the literature. But now it has become a very popular technique because it's a minimally invasive surgery which has shown good clinical outcomes. Between the open and arthroscopic techniques, the rate of union is almost the same, which is more than 90%. The benefits of arthroscopic methods are like any arthroscopic surgery are there. Apart from that, there is a faster time for union, no blood loss, less morbidity, less infection, less soft tissue complication. And moreover, some patients after post-traumatic injury had severe local skin problem where you cannot do open technique. Here, the arthroscopic technique is a benefit and boon for these patients. So these are the various advantages and disadvantages of open and arthroscopic techniques. We all know about it. But the most important is that you have lesser invasion, lesser infection, and early mobilization and discharge from the hospital. The main contraindication for this procedure is active infection in active Charcot neuropathy, but in chronic cases, I think you can still do it if only tibial patellar joint is involved. Avascular necrosis of the talus with more than 30% involvement of talus because we feel it may cause non-union at the arthrodesis. And in patients with severe ankle deformity, where you also require associated osteotomy to correct deformities, the arthroscopic procedure cannot be done. The main USP of our techniques compared to other techniques which are described in the literature, that we use this technique without using any joint distraction and using conventional instruments. So it makes it easily available and approachable to most surgeons. You simply denude the tibial and patellar articular surface with routine arthroscopic shavers and burrs. There is hardly any implant that is used, minimum and cost-saving implants just in the form of two cancellous screws, which are easily available in most hospitals. And tibio-patellar fusion is not always essential, and we did not use in any of our cases. We simply cleared the lateral side of the joint with arthroscopic shaver, and it allowed enough opposition of the tibio-fibular surfaces. So these are the references that we used for writing a paper in 2016. And since then, we have done almost equal number of cases with equally good result. And I would recommend that most of you should try this technique because it is simple and very effective technique. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Do we have any questions from the panel, all the presenters and other faculties?
Thank you, Raju, for a lovely paper. Very informative.
Thank you.
You have different sections of cases. One was osteotic, one was inflammatory, the other one was, if I remember right, PN. Did you have any?
Indications. One was post-traumatic arthritis. Second was post-inflammatory arthritis. Third was AVN. Yes.
And inflammatory. Now, the healing in osteoarthrosis or difficulty in burring in osteoarthritis, especially the far posterior part, how did you, what are the tips and tricks?
You see, you should try to remove all the articular cartilage that is available. Obviously, you cannot reach up to the most posterior part, but that is not essential. The most important is to clear the dome of the talus and the opposing surface of the tibia. And once you have achieved that, you achieve very good union.
Did you have any problem of longer union in AVN?
I only had one case of AVN, so I don't. But as I said, if it is a very extensive AVN, the dome of the talus, you should not do this technique because chances of non-union or pseudoarthrosis at the arthrodesis site is there.
Did you do any, what I'm saying is, did you do any micro fracture, things like that because of
ABS? Oh, all these cases were beyond micro fracture because they were grade 4 arthritis. Micro fracture is only indicated in a focal defect of articular cartilage.
I think I could understand what Dr.
Oh, Nicholas probably you are asking me, did you do any micro drilling?
Yeah.
No, we used extensive burrs. So until the bleeding surface, so we didn't use any micro fracture.
I think what Dr. Raju is telling, because last time when we did the ankle arthroscopy, this webinar also, I presented one live, the video demonstration of the ankle arthroscopy. Yes, Dr. Nicholas sir is asking, I think when you do the arthroscopic ankle arthrodesis, we cannot reach the backside. We have to clear the dome top and down. And also we have to clear, the most important thing is that you have to clear the gutters. That is the most important thing, because if you don't clear the gutters, then you don't expect that it's going to heal.
That's what I said, clear the gutters, but it is not essential to clean all the posterior surface of the talus.
Raju sir, I also do a lot of arthroscopic ankle arthrodesis, but right. I always, the three portals, apart from your regular portal, I always use a posterolateral portal. So what happens that through the posterolateral portal, you can insert a scoop or a Skeman rod, which we can insert between the joint, is almost, it goes in the middle of the joint. So that allows the joint to get distracted even in the posterior aspect of the ankle joint. So you'll be able to reach far better than just going through only anterior medial and anterolateral portal. By keeping your instruments through the posterolateral portal helps you to distract the joint more in the posterior side. So that helps in more preparation.
Yeah.
That means you are trying to distract from the posterior side.
Yes, sir. Posterior block. Yes, sir. When you put the instruments through the posterolateral portal, that distracts the joints.
Yeah.
You see, my view on this is that posterior side, there is hardly much articular cartilage, right? Especially that comes in contact with the tibial surface. So even if you leave it, like I did not do any posterior clearance, I got union in all cases. So why to make things complicated if you can get away with a simple technique?
Yeah, of course. Advantage of doing ankle arthrodesis is just you are keeping the convexity of the talus. So that is a very important point in arthroscopic ankle arthrodesis. Though you definitely no need to go the almost end of the posterior process. So I'm talking about only the posterior part of the dome that is better reachable if you distract through that posterolateral port. I agree, sir. Yeah.
Any other question?
Raju sir, how much deformities you have accepted for the ankle? I know that you are doing open arthrodesis also. How much deformity you accepted
for less than 20 degrees of less than 20 degrees of deformity, whereas valgus or flexion deformity.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. The next speaker is Dr. Abhijeet.
Am I audible? Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Thank you very much. So I just want to take a moment to thank the IAS leadership and especially Professor Raju Vaishya and all my senior colleagues and friends for the opportunity to be a part of this exciting webinar. And it's very heartening to know that research is being undertaken by our society members. And I think this should be more often the norm than the exception. And look forward to hearing many more of such papers. So this particular presentation is based on our article that was published in the Asian Journal of Arthroscopy. It was more of a review article, and it was a part of a symposium on wrist arthroscopy. So we all know that ganglion cysts are perhaps the most common soft tissue tumor that we would see in the wrist joint. And these are usually cystic swellings with mucinous material, and they often arise from the joints and the tendons. And they usually occur from the second to the fourth decades with female preponderance. And there is no specific race or occupational predisposition that has been identified. And in one way, these ganglion cysts are not true cysts because there is no secreting endothelium lining of the cysts. And usually there is a one-way mechanism of a wall-like mechanism that pushes the fluid inside, but it cannot go outside. And they most commonly originate from the scapholunate ligament, and it might extend to the midcarpal joint or the scapho-trapezial joint in a lot of patients that you would see. And there are multiple locations of the cyst. It all depends upon where the cyst can find its way or the stalk of origin. And sometimes even retinacular cysts may coexist with these particular cysts. So ganglion cysts are firm, well-defined cystic tumors with viscous and mucinous contents. They may be single or multiloculated. The wall is smooth, is translucent, and is connected to the underlying joint capsule or the tendon with a stalk or via a stalk. And the cystic contents, they are composed of glucosamine, albumin and globulin, and hyaluronic acid. So they are basically components of the joint fluid, and over a period of time, they become jelly-like when they are retained in the cyst without an escape route back to the joint. This is a schematic diagram to show how the cyst originates. So this is a scapholunate ligament here between the lunate and the scaphoid. And you have the cyst which originates from the scapholunate ligament, and it bulges out to a main cyst, which is defined here, and with satellite cysts or multiloculated cysts that may be present underneath the actual capsule. And these have to be identified, and perhaps arthroscopy gives us the opportunity to look at these cysts and deal with them in a more effective manner. So there are numerous theories regarding the etiology of cysts, and perhaps the one that has been propagated by Angelides and Wallace are more plausible, and they have cited recurrent microtrauma as the reason why these cysts originate. Usually, clinically, people will present with a mass, pain, and weakness. And volar ganglions also may be present, and they have to be identified. They may be present in the carpal tunnel and cause carpal tunnel syndrome. But more often than not, dorsal ganglion cysts are the commonest presentation. The differential diagnosis is myriad and is highlighted in this particular slide. I won't belabor too much on this, but an occasional tumor, especially a synovial sarcoma or a synovial carcinoma, has to be kept in mind as a differential diagnosis and prevent any complications and extensive surgery and morbidity to the patient. More often than not, treatment of ganglion cysts is conservative in nature or non-operative. Even if the patient comes to you with pain, a cosmetic concern or weakness, you would first embark on a non-operative treatment that consists of splinting, massage, and reassurance. And sometimes aspiration may also be offered with or without injection of a local steroid. And you should counsel the patient that these treatment modalities are associated with high recurrence rates because the wall of the cyst often remains back and it may reform. Surgical treatment is usually counseled when people come with recurrence or pain that is not subsiding with non-operative treatment, or a big cosmetic concern such as young women who are going in for marriage, for example. And then surgical treatment usually comprises of either an open, and now more often than not, arthroscopy is the way to go for these particular cysts. Of course, you would perform certain investigations in the form of a plain X-ray, an ultrasound examination, and an MRI to have a better understanding of the anatomy and other information that you can garner from these investigations. So the standard wrist arthroscopy setup is utilized. We use radiocarpal as well as midcarpal portals. And there are multiple ways that you can excise this cyst. You can come in directly. The shaver can come in directly from the cyst or from a more ulnar portal or from the radiocarpal portal, the 1-2 portal from this side. And you have to keep switching your viewing and working portals at all times. A good way to identify the stalk of the cyst is by passing in a needle, and a very small quantity of methylene blue can be injected, but you've got to be very careful because it might cause a blue out rather than what we call as a red out in the joint. So a very small quantity, or you can pass a 2-0 PDS from within the needle, and that would give you the location of the stalk. And then usually we create a small window of about 1 millimeter breadth and length beyond the stalk to ensure that the cyst has been removed completely and there is no recurrence or recurrence is minimized. Here is a small video. This is a dry arthroscopy of the wrist joint. We can see the mucinous material lying in the joint as well. And so to orient you, this is the lunate. I'm viewing from the 6R portal. So this is the lunate, this is the scapholunate ligament, and beyond that particular thing is the scapholunate ligament. Now, I'm just trying to take a biopsy. Any cyst in the body, we always make sure to take a biopsy. So we take a biopsy of the synovial or the cyst, and then you would want to send that material for histopathology. This is a dorsal aspect of the wrist joint. My shaver is coming in from the 3-4 portal, and then gradually we shave off the cyst. So this is dry arthroscopy where you get a very nice perspective of the cyst and then this is the dorsal aspect. So you can see the capsule has been excised, and these are the extensor tendons here. You can see them very well through the rent in the capsule, 1 millimeter window that has been created. And once you have done this excision, you would want to go on to your mid-carpal portal, and that's where the money is. So more often than not, it is in the mid-carpal portal that you'll find the bulk of the cyst. We also use a small radio frequency cautery to buzz off whatever cyst or any bleeding surface is remaining behind. It also gives you some denervation and some pain relief because of the radio frequency cautery. And then I'm just going to advance this. So you go to the mid-carpal portal now, and that's where the cyst is. Now I'm using a little bit of saline to distend the joint because it is a tight joint in a petite lady. And then this is the capitate now for your perspective. This is the capitate. And now you can see the lunate here. And you can see the bellotment of the lunate. So once the cyst is removed, you test for scapholunate integrity. This is the lunate dorsal aspect and the mid-carpal joint. And very quickly, if you find that there is scapholunate instability, we repair the scapholunate ligament by the arthroscopic dorsal capsular ligament release repair technique that we have described in the previous webinar. So this is the paper that I'm alluding to. We had published this in the Journal of Wrist Surgery. Post-operative management is usually bulky dressing for about 3 weeks if no scapholunate ligament repair has been performed. However, if any ligament repair has been performed, we extend the immobilization to up to 6 weeks. Post-operative rehabilitation protocol usually comprises of a range of motion exercises followed by strengthening exercises, and patients are advised to avoid strenuous activities for up to about 3 months, especially in the scenario where a ligament repair has been done. We looked at 15 patients retrospectively. This was as of 2017. With a follow-up of at least 1 year, and we found that in all patients, irrespective of the ligament repair, we found that the DASH and the VAS scores improved post-operatively and with no recurrence at 1 year. These are a few important studies out there in the literature. This one is from Mayo Clinic, where they looked at 41 patients and standard arthroscopic technique was used to deal with these ganglion cysts, and they found that systematically the DASH scores and the VAS scores improved in all of the patients, and they also reported no recurrences. This was a very important study, an extension of which was published with 114 patients with a minimum of 2 years of follow-up. And they found that there were 14 recurrences at 16 months. And they found that the recurrences were directly correlated to the experience of the surgeon and the technique that was used. However, they found that the grip strength, the range of movement, as well as the pain scores improved. This was the only study that we came across where they looked at a comparison between arthroscopic and open excision. And they kind of did not look at the range of movement, but they looked at recurrence and residual pain. And they found there were comparable recurrences between the two groups. I'm done, sir. This is the last slide. In summary, we need to know that both techniques provide acceptable pain control and functional outcomes. And a good amount of practice and learning curve is required for arthroscopic treatment. With that, I thank you for the attention.
Thank you, Abhijeet. Nice paper. I think our friend Mihir has done some presented paper. I remember once at Viroc on dorsal ganglions. Mihir.
Yes,
I
sir.
Give you the privilege of asking the questions.
Yeah, you have very sharp memory. Abhijeet, a very nice paper.
Thank you.
The only difference is I use the traction technique in the horizontal position. I don't use a vertical traction tower because I don't have the tower. I just wanted to ask that of your 17 patients, did you find any chondral injury or any TFCC injury in these patients who had a dorsal ridge ganglion? Because in most of the literature and also in my small study, 30% patient had some intra-articular pathology, and which we know if we don't treat causes or is probably a very common cause for recurrence of these ganglion cysts.
True. So you're absolutely right. Great point that you've raised, and thank you for doing so. So a lot of patients, and pretty much approximately 25 to 30% will have a concomitant injury. We specifically excluded those patients with a chondral injury or a TFCC injury from this study, and only those where we found a scapholunate injury, because that's where most of these ganglion cysts would come from, prima facie. So we included only those patients. But yes, you are absolutely right. And that is the beauty of arthroscopic treatment of ganglion cysts. I believe it gives you an opportunity to look into every nook and corner, and you can prognosticate the treatment in an otherwise unknown realm, and you can advise the patient about the outcomes with these concomitant injuries.
Okay, Abhijeet.
Yeah.
In our country, most of the time, the dorsal ganglions are done by general surgeons or even orthopedic surgeons as open. Very often, there's a recurrence. I'm sure you must have had some chance of seeing a recurrence or treating a recurrent patient that was referred to you. Can you give us your thoughts on that?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. So one of the recurrences that we saw was a synovial carcinoma that I talked about, which was actually treated as a ganglion cyst, and unfortunately no biopsy was done. So no matter how benign you think a tumor is, and you know, you look at the tumor and you know it's a ganglion cyst, yet I would advise that we get a biopsy done, one. Two is, it doesn't matter whether you're doing an open or an arthroscopic technique. I think the technique has to be thorough. You have to identify, you have to recognize that there are satellite ganglion cysts that may be present and they need to be excised. And a good kind of technique with where you remove the entire stalk is perhaps a good way of dealing with this. And post-operative rehabilitation in terms of immobilization is also required to minimize recurrence. However, despite our best efforts, they say that anywhere between 0.2 to 1% recurrence rates have been reported, but you should counsel the patients, keep an eye, and then deal with it accordingly.
Abhijeet, the silly question.
No, sir.
Is there any role of aspiration and injection of steroid, which is being rampantly used by
practice
many colleagues and surgeons? Yeah.
So it is indeed documented and perhaps a well, kind of reported way of dealing with ganglion cysts, especially when a patient is perhaps not ready for surgery. Again, there is a disclaimer. Of all the ganglion cysts I see, I operate upon 1-2% of these ganglion cysts. And it is not that every patient who walks into your clinic is advised a surgery. More often than not, they will rupture, they will disappear. It is only those who really have a severe problem qualify for treatment. Now, you may want to buy time by aspirating and injecting. That also has shown to work in a small percentage of people. But the caveat is that you should advise patients that it might recur. If it solves the problem, well and good. I mean, it's a win-win situation, both for the patient as well as the surgeon. However, if there is a recurrence, then I think surgery is the order of the day.
Okay. Is there any other question, Dr. Sundar, Dr. Swanendu, Raghu?
No. Mir has got a question. Mir, yes, two questions. Yeah. Mir, you have to unmute.
Yeah, Abhijeet.
Yeah.
Again, from personal experience, what happens is you said in case you cannot identify the ganglion stalk from the intraarticular position, we pass a needle through the most prominent aspect of the ganglion, see where the needle ruptures the dorsal capsule and shave it there. But what I have realized many times that the body of the ganglion is far away from where the stalk is. And when we need to shave the dorsal capsule, we need to shave where the stalk originates. So have you any time had the need where you put the needle, okay, but still the stalk has not been excised, or you have to go into the extra-articular compartment with your shaver to get the ganglion out? Any experience of that type that you've had?
So, what I've realized is that you need not keep the cyst intact when you are excising. You know, a lot of people believe that, even if you're doing an open excision, you have to keep the cyst en bloc and remove it en bloc. So if it's a large cyst, it's a multi-loculated cyst, it's a good idea to rupture it perhaps. And so that the volume is reduced, you're not intimidated by the size of the cyst. It is not a very good idea to go extra compartmental because of two reasons. One is that it requires a lot of surgical skill and expertise. Two, it may cause there's an impending risk of a compartment syndrome with the fluid leaking out into the forearm. So I wouldn't recommend that. But to be very honest, I don't recall the last time I was not able to find the cyst. So just like in elbow arthroscopy, use a freer retractor to tent the capsule. You can use a freer elevator or a small kind of an instrument to tent and push the capsule away so that you can see the stalk being stretched out. Or you may have your assistant to push the dorsal capsule inside towards the shaver so that you have a pretty robust way of removing that cyst and the stalk.
So thank you, Abhijeet.
That helps. Thank you,
sir.
Thank you. Now move on to the third speaker, Shirish Pathak. He will be telling us about functional outcomes of combined ACL reconstruction and meniscal repair in a retrospective study.
Thank you, Dr. Raju, sir. And thank you, IAS, for giving me this opportunity. I hope you can see my presentation slide as a full screen.
Yes.
Yeah. So let me start with my presentation. This paper got published last month in Journal of Arthroscopy, Sports Medicine and Rehabilitation. Aim of the study was to assess the functional outcome of arthroscopic combined ACL reconstruction and meniscus repair. So we did a retrospective study from 2014 to 2016 cases. The total number of ACL reconstruction done during this period at my institution were 445. 225 out of this patient had concomitant meniscal tears. And out of those, about 15% of 225, that is 34 patients, underwent ACL reconstruction and meniscus repair simultaneously. The inclusion criteria was concomitant ACL tear with repairable meniscus tear. The duration of presentation was within 3 months from injury. All meniscal tears were longitudinal tears, either in red-red zone or red-white zone. And minimum 6-month follow-up post-surgery was required. The exclusion criteria was discoid and torn meniscus, radial tears, irreparable complex tears, and multi-ligament injuries. we treated 34 patients and 35 menisci. The mean age was 29 years. Range was 17 to 44. The mean follow-up was 18 months. The range was 6 to 24 months. 21 patients out of 34 had for 24 months post-op follow-up. Post-op evaluation, the follow-up visits were at 3, 6, 9, 12, and 24 months. IKDC, Lishom, and VAS score was calculated. And the clinical assessment for meniscal healing was no or minimal pain, no subjective locking, no joint line tenderness, and negative macro-res test. This is the distribution of medial and lateral meniscal stair repair. Out of 35 menisci, 20 were medial side, 13 were lateral, and one patient we repaired both medial as well as lateral meniscus. Surgical technique, all ACL reconstruction were done transportal, single bundle, anatomical. We used quadruple semitigraph. Femoral fixation was done with variable loop endobutton, and tibial fixation was done either with a bias screw or a suture disc. The meniscus repair technique, we by and large use all techniques, all inside, combination of all inside and outside in. These were two major combination of techniques where we utilize this in almost 80% of patient, while in two patient we use only outside in, and in one patient we use all inside, outside in, and inside out. So this video shows roughly how we tackled this meniscal repair. So you can see all techniques. We use double barrel lumen cannula to do inside out. We use a fast fix suture anchor to do all inside. And we use two 18-gauge spinal needles to do outside in repair technique. So we used combination of these techniques to achieve a good meniscal repair. At least 6 to 7 points of repair were used while doing a bucket handle repair technique. Suture configuration in all inside repair. In 24 cases, we used two fast fix anchors. In 3 cases, we used 3. And in 6 cases, we used 1 anchor. When we were using outside in as a combination procedure, we put at least 4 or 5 stitches with non-absorbable braided suture, and same with the inside out. Post-op protocol, we kept patient non-weight bearing for 3 weeks and restricted range of movement up to 90 degree for 3 weeks. Then gradual to full weight bearing was allowed at 4 to 5 weeks. And running and pre-injury activities were started after 6 months post-surgery. Functional assessment, IKDC improved from 38.6 pre-op to 80.3. Lishom improved from 50.3 to 91.4. And VAS pain score reduced from 7.3 to 2 on an average at final follow-up. Statistical analysis using paired t-test, the p-value for IKDC, Lishom, and VAS was significant. Results, the clinical success rate of healing for meniscus repair was 89%. 4 patients out of 35 menisci repair had re-tears. All of them were medial meniscus tears, which were in the red-white zone. 3 tears were diagnosed after 6 months, and 1 tear was diagnosed at 18-month post-op. We did MRI scan for all patients who came for re-tear or failure of repair. Out of 4, 2 patients underwent with partial meniscectomy, while 2 patients opted for conservative treatment. The limitations of the study, this was a small sample size with short follow-up. Diagnosis of failure or healing was purely clinical, and MRI was not done in routine post-op evaluation. Conclusion, arthroscopic meniscal repair along with ACL reconstruction provided predictably high rates of meniscal healing and yielded favorable functional and clinical results. Patient selection remains one of the most important prognostic factors. Thank you.
Thank you, Shirish. A very good series.
Thank you.
I have a couple of questions. Did you lose any patient to follow up? Because it's a retrospective study. It seems you did not lose any patient to follow up, which is surprising.
So this was a retrospective study. So we enrolled those patients only who had minimum 6-month follow-up. And as it was a clinical evaluation, So those patients who did not come, did not agree, we did not enroll them on.
Right. And why you had VAS score of 2 by 10 at the end of your follow-up? Why these patients were still painful?
Yeah, so most of patients had ACL reconstruction with meniscus. We went into the detail for this VAS scoring pain. Most of them had patellofemoral pain. Most of them had some pain along the MCL. But those patients who had this pain never complained a significant pain along the joint line. So we took that as a positive criteria for healing. So if they complained pain at the joint line, then we suspected a retear. And then we got MRI scan and we could find 4 patients had retear.
And how did you confirm that meniscus repair have healed? Because you did not do MRI in all the cases.
No, this was a purely clinical evaluation. We did MRI scan for a few patients, but we did not include that as part of this study to publish because the number was very small. Only 7 patients underwent MRI scan because it is very difficult to convince them to get MRI scan, especially when they have no symptoms. And this was not sponsored.
So there may be silent retear which are not clinically symptomatic. They may be partial retears.
Okay. Yes, so that was also mentioned as the limitation that asymptomatic retears probably we have missed.
All right.
Shirish, thank you.
May I ask
you a question, Shirish?
Yes, sir, please.
What is the sign you see clinically when you pre-op you see a patient and post-op when you want to see a follow-up? All right, my meniscus has healed, my meniscus has not healed. What can you tell us?
Yeah, so see, these were typically longitudinal tears which were confirmed on MRI preoperatively. And of course, in arthroscopy, we evaluated. And out of, as I showed, we operated 225 patients with ACL with meniscal pathology. Rest 85% of patients, either we did a partial meniscectomy or we just left those tears to heal on their own. Those whom we operated, we keenly looked at their joint line tenderness, any subjective locking symptoms, and overall their scores for IKDC and Lishom. Those who did well, we considered that probably their meniscus have healed. But as I said, there is a possibility that we might have missed those who were asymptomatic. But only way is to get MRI scan. But again, getting MRI scan, there are a lot of limitations with MRI scan also, because you do see a lot of scar tissue, which is very difficult to comment whether it is really healed or it is just a scar and it's an innocent mark on the MRI scan.
Okay, I will just give you one clinical this. Between the red-red zone, red-white zone and white-white zone, there are definite clinical this. Whenever there's a pain, whenever at the red-red junction, there's invariably pain. But when it comes more towards the center, the pain element and excruciating pain part become less and less.
Yes, I agree.
So can I make a comment?
Thank you. We move on to the next speaker, Dr. Raghuveer Reddy, who will be telling us about trochleoplasty and combined medial MPFL reconstruction.
Sir, Dr. Sundar has something to say, sir.
Okay, Sundar.
I want to ask Shirish, because the follow-up is, average follow-up is around 6 months. We know that any ACL patient with the meniscus repair, when they go back to the routine activities, maybe including running or a sports activity, or including that hard activities, it takes 8 to 9 months time. And also the repair which we do nowadays with the bucket handle tear repair with so many stitches around that, we know that literature also has shown that these stitches can hold that meniscus very well, even if it is not healed for quite a long time. Maybe that may be another limitation because of the follow-up period. Sometimes we may not know that non-healing meniscus till maybe 1 year or 1.5 years till they go back to the routine activities.
Yes, Sundar, the average follow-up was 18 months. Okay, so 24 okay. patient had 24 month follow-up. Minimum was 6 months. I agree, okay. but that is, okay. these are the limitations. So the intention of paper was to make surgeons believe that meniscus repair works.
Yeah, I understood.
Raju sir, can I ask a question?
Yeah, quick.
Shirish, in your technique part, you have chosen most of inside out and outside in. Inside out is chosen much less. You have done mostly all inside and outside in. Inside out is less.
Yeah, that's a very good point. So this study was done in 14 to 16. So that time my preference was all inside plus outside in. But if you ask me in last 3 years, I'm doing primarily inside out and all inside and minimum of outside in. So I think that's my personal evolution. So I agree. Now I'm using more of inside out, which I think is more reproducible and gives a better repair configuration.
Yeah.
Yep. Shall we move to the next speaker? Raghuveer, are you ready?
Yes, sir. I thank IAS, Dr. Raju sir and Nicholas sir for invitation to this platform. This case report was, surgery was done in 2010, published in 2012. And I faced a lot of problems initially because there was no one to guide me in 2010 how to do this case in India. And limited videos available like WOMED educational thing. So regarding the surgical technique, I have to ask Dijo, and he has given me guidance. And in 2010, and I submitted for the IGO publication, but it got rejected saying that it is only one case. So I have to wait for 2 years to get again published. This female, 18 years, had instability since age of 14 years. Already once operated in 2007, lateral dislocation, lateral extensive neomoplasty in 2008, still patellar is dislocating. So patellar engages in trochlear groove in 60 degrees of flexion. You can see the previous scars. So this was the skyline view. So I know this was a dysplasia. So I went to a review of literature. So then I came to know that a lot of major and minor instability factors, they put acute threshold and cause MPFL rupture and later go for chronic patellar dislocation, recurrent. And initial 30 degrees of flexion 0-30 is brought by soft tissue restraints. Beyond 30 degrees is by bony restraints. And I came to know about trochlear dysplasia classification. Our case was a type B trochlear dysplasia. And you said that low-grade dysplasia only MPFL reconstruction suffice, whereas high-grade dysplasia requires both sulcus-dependent trochleoplasty and MPFL. So depending on venue, I have decided to do lateral release to medial patellofemoral ligament reconstruction and trochleoplasty by guidance of Dijo. And we have taken thick osteochondrosis plan. And our goal was to create new trochlea, do the trochlea mapping. Is created proximally and laterally from the original sulcus. So thereby you are correcting the TTD distance proximally. So once we expose, peritrochlear periosteum and seronium was incised. Initially we used the osteotomes to elevate, later we used the small dental burr. And we use more in the center part of the proposed groove, we remove the more bone there. Since it's a dissolved one, it's a thick cartilage flap, we have to split the cartilage in the new groove part. And that was, video was not this urgent patient. This video belongs to some other patient. Actually, I didn't record when the surgery was being done because of being tensed up. Only taken photographs. So these were trochleoplasty, and I did MPFL reconstruction single bundle and lateral raise. So in 2005, I first attended the ESO course there. So normally we are in India, we are talking of MC Pilat, or Campbell's procedures for the recurrent patellar dislocation. But there, the first time I come to know that MPFL is being done, something was there in the patellar femur session, only around 15 to 20 doctors were discussing about it, about MPFL reconstruction rate, which is more popular now. So MPFL is stiff grafts. If any, you make a small error in graft length attachment sites, there'll be increased patellar femoral loading and there can be a decreased range of motion. And if you graft length change patterns on femoral attachment point, the femoral attachment point is more sensitive, especially superior and anterior portion. If you place an MPFL reconstruct more proximally, there'll be loss of knee flexion. There can be excessive pressure on male patellar. If you place MPFL reconstruct more distal, it causes tight MPFL in extension and lax in flexion, and it can cause extensor lag. So if lengthening occurs in flexion, this is what we do in isometric method. Move the femoral attachment more distal. If lengthening occurs in extension, move the femoral attachment proximal. So actually the reconstruction, first time I did in 2005, 1 year before that, this was not a recurrent patellar dislocation. This is a case of a multiple ligament injury, ACL and grade 3 MCL. One of my friends has put in a cylindrical cast for 7 weeks and he has referred to me. Once I opened this, his patella was in the lateral gutter. It was not reduced. So even under anesthesia, then I have to go for open reduction. So what I attended from the esophagus, I applied this here. You can see medial structures are not there. I'm not passing in the, there's no first layer between second and third layer, it is not there. So this is the surgery I had done in 2005, not for recurrent patellar dislocation. This is for neglected patellar dislocation. So the, what is important is graft position between the arctic tubercle and medial precondyle. By doing isometric method, it should become lax flexion. And we should fix in the angle where patella engages in trochlea and use a low tension method. I used to use a fix with a fast track anchor and periosteum. And this is the 6 months after the surgery. So Dr. Dijor has guided me to how to use the staples. He told me to use a thin K wire. At either end, you sharpen it. One end is sharp, and you make it as a staple. The simple idea he has given me, Dijor. And this is 1 year after trochleoplasty. And from the superior lateral portal, I want to remove the staple. This is 1 year after the surgery. You can see the patellofemoral cartilage status. And this is a staple. And later in 2007, esophagus, people started using a shorter method of thumb, where surgery has become easier for the femoral tunnel. And the double bundle concept, double strands has come. So what I would do now in the same case, I would be doing lateral retinal lengthening, Brittle's deep in trochleoplasty, I take thinner flap and fix with ganglion and anchors and double-stranded MPPL and aggressive rehab. So normally if you see instability at higher degrees of flexion, even at 90 degrees of flexion, still it's patellar subluxation. You think of bony dislocation, like bony component. So how it is? I do lateral retinal lengthening. If a retinal problem is if it's tight, I lengthen the retinaculum. And I use the same approach if I do retinaculum. You can go for, instead of going mirror patellar approach, same approach, I go from lateral side. And trochlea mapping is done on the roof, on the point of the roof, on the funnel notch. The groove is compressed, new groove is compressed. I'm fixing it soil of anchor in the intracranial notch, figure one. And small anchors are used for spinal oxford, peripheral part. So here I use thinner cartilage flaps compared to Dijor's one. And fix with microly. Now you can see the tracking. Even at higher degrees of flexion, it is stable. 30, 45, 90. This patient has come from UK, he's a student there. He has come only for this surgery. This exactly 8 weeks after surgery, he left India. So take home message, since it's a case report. So So think of dysplasia, trochlear dysplasia, if the patellar instability is higher degrees of flexion, osteogenesis at higher degrees. So high grade dysplasia B and D requires trochleoplasty along with MPFL reconstruction. A little tilted, more less than 11 degrees also think of dysplasia. Is contraindicated open growth plates and mild trochlear dysplasia and ulnar arthritis. So low grade dysplasia like ANC, MPFL reconstruction will suffice, whereas high grade dysplasia requires both sulcus deepening, trochleoplasty and MPFL. And thanks for patient hearing. And I met Dijon for first time in 2017 after this procedure, but he couldn't recollect what happened 7-8 years back.
Thank you, Dr. Raghuveer, for a nice enlightening paper. You always measure the TTG distance also in these situations, or you only go on the grading of the dysplasia?
Yeah, I measure the TTG distance. Normal, what you are doing is, we are actually decreasing the TTG distance proximally. So once we do the trochleoplasty and see that patella is engaging in the trochlear groove, so further tibial tuberosity surgery means transfer is not required. In case of still, even after trochleoplasty, there is not instability, then we can go for tibial tuberosity transfer. So actually we are correcting the TT distance proximally instead of distally.
Oh, I see.
Because once we bring the new trochlea, we are lateralizing it. So new trochlea is lateralizing means it is coming near to the tibial tuberosity. That means indirectly we are reducing the TTG distance.
What exactly you do in lengthening of the lateral adnagnum?
Lengthening is here, the lateral adnagnum is split in two layers, superficial and deeper. So later superficial and deeper is sutured. So basically it is, the lateral joint is not open, it's not kept open.
Raghu?
Yeah.
By doing the sulcus, now you do a sulcus lateralization in your trochleoplasty. So in that, how much maximum you can correct the TTG distance? Because you just shift the sulcus slightly from that from the abnormal position to the central or lateral position. How much maximum you can correct the TTG distance in that?
I think it's around 8 to 9 mm maximum, 8 to 9 mm. And we are shifting the trochlear groove around 6 degrees, 5 to 6 degrees.
Maximum. Yeah.
So you cut a wedge or you burr the bone, what exactly you do? You didn't show that part.
I showed you. But since I didn't have time, if you are interested, I'll show. No, first what we do is we incise the peritrochlear synovium, periosteum and synovium. Using a thin osteotome, you mark the with osteotome where you, how much you want to go to depth. So make a initial cut with osteotome. Later you take a dental burr, the long burr. So you keep on removing the bone. So that means you first elevate the perimeter of the trochlea. Cortex is elevated. And where you wanted to remove the, create the trochlea, there you remove more bone.
No, no, but there must be some experience guidelines on this. No, what I'm saying is I didn't understand how deep you go, where to stop.
If you want to see the video, I'll show for 30 seconds.
Oh. No, is there, depending upon the type of patella, trochlea you go, is there some criteria on that?
Is no. You do step by step, that's all. See and do it, that's all.
Okay.
So thank you, Raghuveer. Now we move on to Vijay Shetty, who will be enlightening us with hip arthroscopy. Vijay, please.
I think Vijay Shetty was one of the new guys who popularized the hip arthroscopy in India.
Is Vijay there?
Yeah. Vijay.
Yes.
Thank you, Dr.
Okay. Yeah.
So nice to speak to you after a long time. And
yeah.
Thank you for the opportunity and thanks a lot for inviting me for this exciting webinar. I think we've been busy these days in spite of being affected by lockdown. So this is this one second. OK. Can you see the screen now?
Yes. Yes.
Hello?
We can see.
Yeah. Okay. So when Dr. Vaishya asked me to speak on this one, especially because I think one of his publications he did a few years ago, top 10 Indian publications on arthroscopy. I think this was one of them. And these are my disclosures. And this is the article that I published in 2007, along with the Mr. Wheeler of Cambridge. And I spent a good 1 year with him. And it was like spending 4 years because we used to start at 4:30 in the morning and finish by 8:30 in the evening every day, except Saturdays and Sundays. So too much exposure. So I think when we started off, my interest was hip arthroscopy, and I finished my fellowship. I came back and he mailed me saying, you should now write a current concept review. So I did that. And this was actually, if you go back, it's a narrative review. It's not like a systematic review. So we just wrote on how things are done with hip arthroscopy worldwide. So the story of hip arthroscopy, even today, it's evolving. It's one of innovation, experimentation, and ultimately success. And if you really, I mean, we had a webinar recently with IAS again on hip arthroscopy, and you see the indications growing so fast now. So if you, I think this is quite fascinating, you know, 1931, when people tried hip arthroscopy, they were not even talking about hip arthroscopy at that time, because this gentleman, who was supposed to be one of the greatest endoscopists at the time, from New York, said that at that time there were no indications at all, simply because he felt that it was difficult to put a straight scope in a ball and socket joint. And for about 6 decades, nothing was happening. 6 years, nothing was happening. In 1991, Jim Click first published, there was a concern about a lot of people coming with groin pain without a diagnosis and leaving the sports or any activities of that sort. So he mentioned in his article that nearly about 4 out of 10 people are not diagnosed what's really happening in the hip joint at the time. And then Tom Bird in 1997, I think these are some landmark papers which actually popularized hip arthroscopy at the time. And you would have met Tom Bird, tall man, and he published in 1997 saying that the indications are fast growing for hip arthroscopy. And Joe McCarty in 2005, he wrote a very interesting book and saying this is one of those statements that kept that came again time and again in many publications, saying comprehensive access to hip arthroscopy provided access to an evolving conditions that affect the hip joint. And these conditions were previously unrecognized and left untreated. And a very, very powerful statement. And in the, I think the article is about talking about indications, talking about how fast the investigations have grown. And there are X-rays, arthrography, isotope scan, CT, and MRI. And I think for those who are not aware of this situation, this X-ray might just go normal. Just go normal as there's nothing much to see. But if you are a hip surgeon, you will notice that there is something called a prominent ischial spine, which indicates impingement, which is a very, very important finding on a plain X-ray of the hip pelvis with both hip joints. And if you go one step further, then you see a CT scan of the hip joint, 3D reconstruction, you see there is a os acetabulum, which would otherwise go unnoticed and unrecognized. And further, going further, MRI scans showing intralabral cysts and synovitis around the hip joint, and you see the chondrolabral junction, there is a tear. This is another MR arthrograph, which is showing the defect. And pigmented villonodular synovitis. I just picked up a few slides, which I inherited from Mr. Wheeler, just to show the indications that are happening. And this is, again, very interesting. If you see, this is a traction set that we used to use in Cambridge in way back in 2005, devised by Richard Willer. And eventually, when I visited him again a few years later in London, I saw this beautiful setup from Smith and Nephew. And of late, you have this system from Arthrex indicating that it's fast evolving, including the instrumentation. For those of us who are not aware of, who are not so popular with the hip arthroscopy, I think most surgeons like to divide a hip area into an intra-articular, extra-articular, or a central compartment or a peripheral compartment, which is becoming very popular now. So these are the indications. I think it's fast growing. I don't want to read through this one, but of most important in our scenario is loose bodies and synovial chondromatosis. I think these are the two conditions which most surgeons in our country are doing at this point, but there are extended indications like post-THR, et cetera. These are some slides I inherited from Mr. Willer. This is one of those beautiful extra-articular pathology, gluteus medius. He's just done release, and I was there, witnessed this surgery at the time. And trochanteric bursa, a lot of people are doing now extra-articular hip arthroscopy to excise the trochanteric bursa. And again, as I mentioned, I think probably one of the good indications or the best case scenario for a hip arthroscopy for us is loose bodies in the hip joint. One of the rare, very rare conditions, I haven't actually seen a case report of this yet, but this is again a slide from Richard Wheeler showing an intra-articular lipoma in the middle of the hip joint. You just see here, a beautiful picture. And this is a post-THR hip arthroscopy where you see some impingement of the neck and you see the corrosion of the femoral stem, and there is some debris, and this explains the pain post-THR. As I mentioned earlier, there are contraindications, but it depends on the surgeon. I think very, very important is how good the surgeon is in doing these operations. When I published this paper, I was supposed to write to a British Journal of Sports Medicine saying what is already known. What was known at the time was that hip arthroscopy was once thought was not possible, and now it's happening everywhere. And what my article added to that, the slide on your right is very, very relevant. You see, around 2000, year 2000, it really shot up, and this is now. But my article at the time, which is around 12 years ago, mentioned about this, saying this is growing and it's going to grow. So I think it's very, very important to know the indications and know our limits as surgeons. We should know whether we are able to perform this procedure or not. And at the same time, we need to stick to evidence-based indications and contraindications. And there are seniors, there are teachers, and if you wish to have some information and if you want to take up hip arthroscopy in your practice, the help is always available at the International Society of Hip Arthroscopy. And recently I wrote a chapter for this book, which is just published last year, about hip arthroscopy in India, a perspective. And this book is a very popular destination now for those who want to take up hip arthroscopy in their practice. Thank you for your attention. That's 6 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Vijay, for a nice paper, nice overview of things, what we can see in hip arthroscopy, the evolution, and how far it has scope. And those who are interested to go deeper into hip arthroscopy, you have also shown the website. So how is hip arthroscopy progressing in your hands now?
So I'll be honest. I don't think it's progressing much. I don't know. We are trying to speak to people in India. In fact, you're probably aware that we just recently conducted a survey among the orthopedic surgeons in our country, and 45 people actually responded. and of which 90% of them said that they're doing less than 10 hepatoscopies in a year, which is quite an alarming scenario. And a few weeks ago, we had IAS-sponsored webinar with Prasad from the US and someone from South Africa. And we were all talking about this. And I don't know what's happening. I published one paper with Lalit Meni, the current Indian Journal of Orthopedics editor. And we looked at 100 people in the army and looked at the incidence of femoroacetabular impingement in our country, alpha angle and all that stuff. So we realized that there was a huge misunderstanding, if you like, about the existence of femoroacetabular impingement in our country. So I think that is one of the major indications at this point. So again, I think we are coming up with an article for the IJO soon, and we'll probably address some points in the article.
Good. Yes, Shirish?
Yeah, so I have just one comment and a question to Dr. Vijay. We are doing a bit of hip arthroscopy at our institute. We found that we do get more number of pediatric patients. Of course, because of my pediatric orthopedic colleague is very keen to get them scoped. So what is your experience? Because we did 6 or 7 pediatric patients like post-parthetic sequelae or post-infective sequelae with where we could do some arthroscopic procedure to take the FAI due to CAM or some sort of procedures, which probably he would have needed to do surgical dislocation.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. No, I think, yes, it's a very good thing. In fact, hepatoscopy is much easier in children. I think, Dr. Prasad Guruneni, he's got large number of pediatric scopy procedures. Yes. In fact, he was in the meeting last time. Here I have done few cases for transient synovitis. In fact, I published that some years ago. So that was for, along with Dr. Atul Bhaskar, who came with the patient and he didn't want to open the joint. So we did synovectomy, debridement, and it really worked well.
Right.
So, but if you ask me, I don't want to talk like an expert because I'm not doing that much, that numbers, seriously. Yeah.
Mute.
So this was a publication.
Vijay.
Go ahead.
Every time when you hear hip arthroscopy, I'm enthusiastic. Every time when I go to a conference or a cadaver course, I'll come back and tell all my consultants, please refer cases for hip arthroscopy. Unfortunately, I do maybe 2 cases per year. That too, last case which I did in calcifications. So it's very difficult to get FAI in our patients. Even patient, we have a lot of total hip replacement patients in a unit like in Ganga Hospital. I tell the surgeon, please refer in early cases if you have an impingement. Even if they refer, when I ask the patient, 1 or 2 patients who had FAI, fulfilled the criteria, they say, I'm symptomatic only, I'm squatting. Otherwise, I'm all right, completely all right. So I don't want to do any surgery. So what is your take on the situation?
Sundar, I just wanted to share this with you. Sorry. Is that mine? Yeah. So, I do mini arthrotomy. Yeah, I'll tell you why. Because when I left Richard Willer's practice, impingement was basically taking off. A lot of people are doing central compartment, peripheral compartment, all that. And I have done few. In fact, I presented this paper at the ROC in January, orthopedic conference. And so I do mini arthrotomy to clear CAM impingement. The indication is very, very clear. It's not for pincer impingement. For CAM impingement, I do a lateral, anterolateral approach about 3 inches. And I go between the muscles. I take a T incision on the capsule. I expose the neck, and then I take an ENT burr, and we, under image control, and we reshape the femoral neck, as in Philip bulb. So that's what I do, and I have about 12 cases now, and I'm very, very impressed with the results. But we have to be very careful. It has to be only CAM impingement. And it's very rare because most impingements are usually combined.
Combined, yeah. So in our scenario, it's very difficult to cut. As Shirish said, I think, sir, in a pediatric situation, so the post-operative, I think it's a very good indication to for the CAM impingement. But in the adult, I think we are not getting cases as like what in the Western world.
Yeah, again, Sundar, very interesting thing. You know, we were doing this survey, and only in some institutions, the numbers are big. We are under the impression that it's big worldwide, and no, not even in the West, where they're doing a lot in Australia and in Europe. It's only some surgeons who have large numbers, not all of them. It's not like arthroplasty where, you know, everybody has big numbers in our country. It's not that. So it's only a few big names have big numbers.
Sundar, can you talk about your paper, please?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Sundar?
Sir, I'm sharing, sir. One minute, sir.
All right.
So can you share, can you see my slides?
Yeah.
Okay, sir. So thank you, Antao sir and Raju sir, for the opportunity to present this paper. So this paper was published 1.5 years before in the Orthopedic Journal of Sports Medicine. And this is regarding comparison of KD3M and KD3L injuries along with analysis of predictive factors that influence the outcomes in single stage reconstruction of these KD3 injuries. Why we chose only KD3, and we know that the KD2 injuries are always, results are predictable whether you treat conservatively or operate. Whichever method you do it, perfectly, then KD2 results always good. Of course, the KD4 and KD5 have a more worse prognosis, and most number of patients what we see is KD3 injuries. So that's why the paper we chose only KD3 injuries. We know that a lot of controversies are in the management of multiligamentous injuries, including the timing of surgery,
I think we have lost Dr. Sundar's connection. Sir, so shall we go ahead with the next?
Okay, either we wait or then I start with my paper, we wait for him to come back?
I think now let's see first. We need to stop sharing.
Yeah, correct. That's right.
Can you talk to him and see?
I'll talk to him meanwhile.
Shall we ask Mihir to then?
I think so. So save time, we'll ask Mihir. But
he has to stop sharing till that nobody can do anything.
Okay. Sandeep has no control over it?
I'm trying, sir. Mir, just try and start sharing. Let's see.
Should I try sharing?
Yes. Please.
You cannot start sharing while participant is sharing.
Now try again.
It's working.
But still we cannot see your screen. I think Dr.
Sandeep, can you see us?
Sir, we can see you.
Okay. Can you see my slides?
No, sir. It is stuck on your previous presentation.
Sorry, 1 minute, I'll share my screen.
Sandeep, we are still seeing the presentation of Sundararajan.
Yes, sir.
So that I can read. I have to show.
No, he's come back down.
All right.
but it's not moving. Sandeep, can you unshare it again? I can.
Sir, just give some time. We need to do it, but it's not happening.
Oh, sorry. Because suddenly it got shut down.
Correct, correct. Yeah. Okay, sir.
Okay, sorry.
Please.
Sandeep, can you see me now? Slides?
Not yet.
Not yet. Not yet. Click on share, sir.
Yeah, yeah. 1 minute. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Arthrodesis.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you see me? Yeah.
Yes,
sorry.
Yes, yes.
Sorry about the interruption. I don't know why suddenly it's collapsed. So we chose only KD3 injuries, and we focused on more of a single stage versus stage surgery. So we took one only on single stage surgery because of controversies in this. We know that many articles on staged approaches were with very good results. Basically, they did this staged approach mainly to reduce the arthrofibrosis by reducing the operative time. That was one of the most important complications expected in multi-ligament injuries. And also, we should not forget that when you do a stage surgery, it takes at least 3 to 6 months between the two stages, and it takes 2 rehabilitation programs. And when you do a single stage, the advantage is you minimize the morbidity of these 2 surgeries. It also reduces a lot of cost and time, and you no need to do rehabilitation twice for the patients, especially it's important for our scenario. So, however, there are not much studies in the literature comparing the single stage surgery of KD3M and KD3L. And also we try to analyze the factors like age, time since injury, energy of trauma, whether fracture dislocation at the time of injury affects more, and the treatment modality of collateral ligament injuries and associated injuries. And it's a prospective case series done in the 2011 to 15. In Ganga Hospital, around 45 patients. Of course, we had excluded the patients with open fracture dislocations, arthritis, or previous surgeries over the same knee. And average age was around 38, and 39 were male, and 9 patients had a frank dislocation, and 36 patients had a transient dislocations, and we had 31 of KD3M injuries and 14 of KD3L injuries. And our protocol for acute injuries, when a patient presents acute, if the knee is stable, we put them on a hinge knee brace. It doesn't mean that day means we are not talking about day one, that we put on a hinge knee brace. We allow the swelling to subside for 1 or 2 weeks time. Then we start moving the knee joint. Once we get more than 90 degrees of movements, then we go ahead to do a single stage surgery. If the same time, if the knee is unstable at the time of presentations, we put on external fixator and we remove it after 2 to 3 weeks, and we remove the external fixator and move the knee and again try to get back the 90 degrees of movements and go and operate on single stage surgery. And this is one of the example of transient dislocation of the left knee with the PCL, ACL and MCL tear, and also with the displaced medial meniscus with the meniscocapsular separation. And as you see, that intraoperative video shows that unstable knee, including the patellar subluxations. And you can see that the intraoperative picture, where you can see the medial side injury of MCL with the meniscocapsular separation. And after doing the ACL and PCL reconstruction in this case, we can see that medial side was open and it was repaired that with the meniscocapsular separation. Then MCL was repaired. As it is a mid-substance tear, it was augmented with the semitendinosus graft. And there was the full range of movements with a good functional outcome in this case. This is another example of KD3L injury, where 22-year-old female had a rotatropic accident with the frank dislocation at the time of presentation. And this was X-ray after the removing the external fixator and moving the knee joint of 90 degrees. So this patient was put on external fixator because of the instability. And this patient was operated almost at the end of the 3 to 4 weeks time, where you can see that the lateral side, there's a huge opening that is a popliteus. You could see that is the avulsion from the femoral side. Still, you can see the only avulsion from the femoral side. So this patient underwent PCL and ACL reconstruction. At the same time, the lateral side was open. the avulsed piece, popliteus and LCLs was repaired with the suture anchors. When you analyze the results, the average follow-up was around 24 months and the average score, IKD score improved up to 74 and LISAM score is 87 and average knee flexion, which we got around 126. And these are the analyses were done using multiple tests for the different criteria. When we analyze the timing of surgery with the functional outcome, we see that when you have acute surgery, acute patients, that is within the 6 weeks of surgeries, patients had a better functional scores compared to the subacute and chronic cases. And we found that this is a better results in acute cases. When you compare the frank dislocation with the transient dislocation, the frank dislocation patients had a less scores compared to the transient dislocation. At the same time, this improvement has over the period of follow-up of a few years that scores had improved when what we see on initial stages. When we analyze the other factors like a type of grafts where we use in some cases only all tendon grafts or some cases we had used graft with bone and one end like a PTB or a quadriceps tendon, it doesn't make any difference in the outcome. And the energy of trauma, the low or high energy trauma, we didn't have a different functional outcome, almost same. When we even the collateral ligament injury, which we talked about MCL and the LCL, and both almost behave samely with the same amount of functional outcome. However, I will talk about in discussion about that in further follow-ups. So these patients are all 2 years follow-ups, a short-term follow-up. And when you treat collateral ligaments, whether you do a conservative repair or reconstruction with augmentation, again, the scores were same. But we chose conservative repair or reconstruction of the collateral ligament injury, depending upon the level of the injury and the assessment of the laxity after doing the PCL and the ACL reconstruction. So our assessment of collateral ligament injury after doing the reconstruction of the PCL and the ACL, we assess the laxity. If it is grade 3, we do a repair. If it is an avulsion, if it is a mid-substance tear, we do augmentation. In chronic cases, we do a reconstruction. So our remaining patients, grade 1 and 2, we treated conservatively. We can see around that is around 10 patients, and the remaining 35 are underwent repair or augmentations. So these patients didn't have a, whether they have a meniscal injury or even associated injuries like a chondral injury, and no statistical significance, but still we could agree that it's only short-term follow-up in the we don't know. The age showed no association with the outcome, whether it's an young patient or a 45 years old with the short-term follow-up, they behaved almost same. But we also found that the significant difference in the laxity measured in stress radiographs where we had in acute cases, the translation was less compared to the chronic cases and in subacute cases. However, we know that there is no correlation between the functional outcome and the amount of laxity which we found, and clinical significance is doubtful. We had two patients of arthrofibrosis which needed intervention, and one patient had a graft donor site which required a debridement. To discuss, we know that there is a mixed evidence in the literature, but if you see the the last few years literature, there are many papers comes with good functional outcome in single stage surgery as like in our study. And also timing of surgery also shows the lateral literature has shown. And also our studies also shows that if you operate in the first 6 weeks, you could with a single stage, still you can come out with the good results. And when we compared KD3M and KD3L, even though literature shows that medial side injuries will far less than the lateral side injuries, and our results are almost same on the both the sides, especially in the functional outcome. So the treatment of collateral ligament injury, and our studies have shown no difference, mainly because of the selection of the treatment which you choose after the laxity assessment. If it's a grade 3, if it's an avulsion, we do a repair. But if it's a mid-substance tear, we do an augmentation or a reconstruction. However, the limitation of a study is because it's a case series and no comparison with the two-stage management. Of course, we didn't do no objective evaluation of laxity. To conclude, single-stage surgery in KD3 gives better results. Transient dislocation patients had a better outcome than the Franklin dislocation. Even though literature shows better results in medial side reconstruction than repair, okay, in our study had shown all kind of treatment had shown no difference. Age, graft choices, grade of collateral ligament injuries and associated injuries did not influence the functional outcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Sundar. Any questions? Yes, Shirish.
So, Sundar, I have a question about surgical technique on lateral side. You did an acute repair or repair with augmentation with graft, whether a Larson type or Lapra type. I was not very clear.
Yeah. So the patients who had avulsion from the femoral side, in the lateral side, we had done the repair. Whoever patient has got a lateral ligament midsubstance tear in acute cases, we augmented with the graft. In chronic cases, we had done a 3 Larsons and 2 Laparidae. So we decide depending upon the, because in the chronic cases, we know that we decided depending upon the lateral opening and with external rotation, we decided to do either Larson or a Laparidae.
Okay. And what was the graft selection? Because you did all three in single go.
Yeah. So we see, as you see that in most of the cases where we do a repair, we don't require a third graft. We required only 2 grafts. So many of the cases we used only all hamstring tendon graft from both the sides. And patients where we required a third graft, usually we used a few cases we used quadriceps tendon and few, and I think 10 cases we used patellar tendon graft.
Okay.
The last, I mean, this is the paper which was published on 2015, but now we are using a lot of allografts because we have access for the allografts.
Okay.
Sundar, nice paper.
Yes,
see, hearing, just now we heard Robert on the anatomy of the lateral and medial side.
Yes, sir.
And he showed so much of anatomy on the lateral side that we don't know.
Yes, sir.
And at, you know, it's amazing to see just doing reconstruction that the medial and lateral side do not vary much. Your take on that?
Sir, absolutely agree. But as I said, I didn't include some of the slides which are post-operative laxity and the final follow-up where we treated conservatively or we operated, especially in the medial-sided injuries, we found that grade 1-2 laxity at the end of the stress X-ray. When you do a stress X-ray at the 6 months, you see the opening. Even though a patient may not have any complaint, but in stress X-rays, it has a grade 1-2 opening. Because patient, but it doesn't relate to the patient outcome because they didn't bother, they don't know whether they have a laxity at all in the medial side. But always I found the lateral side when they have a more opening because these patients will go for a varus deformity and always these patients will have a problem. These patients require always a secondary surgery.
Last question, this segment of population was all sportsmen or non-sportsmen or what is it?
The majority are road traffic accidents. They are not sports persons, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Sundar, one question.
Any other question, please?
Yes, sir. One question. Sundar,
yes, sir,
since you are opted to do single stage, most often is after 3 weeks.
Yeah.
So mostly your case will be less of repair, more of augmentation or reconstruction.
So even if we operate after 3 weeks, Raghu, if you see an avulsion, especially on the femoral side, always it's like a periosteal avulsion. You have a lateral side, you have a popliteus and LCL avulsion.
We lost him.
I think, Mihir, you can start off.
Okay, I'll start sharing my screen.
Yes, yes, Mihir.
Can you all see the screen?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, good evening to all of you all. I'm presenting. I'm presenting my paper of arthroscopic fixation of anterior cruciate ligament tibial bony avulsion using the suture bridge pullout technique and evaluation of results. Okay, so it was a retrospective study which included the ACL tibial avulsion fractures type 2, 3, 4, basically the displaced ones. And the undisplaced ones were excluded. A total of 12 patients were included in this study. All of them were operated by me under spinal anesthesia using a high thigh tourniquet and an arthroscopic leg holder. I use the standard anterolateral portal for viewing, standard anteromedial portal for instrumentation, and a high anteromedial portal for suture management. a 2 centimeter anteromedial skin incision is used for drilling of the wires. So this is a continuous video which shows the procedure. So diagnostic arthroscopy is done, hematoma is drained, and the fracture fragment is confirmed, and the continuity of ACL is also confirmed. Concomitant meniscal pathologies are taken care of at this stage. Most of the cases had the ACL bony avulsion as a swivel of bone, only about 2 to 3 mm in thickness, with the ACL fibers holding everything. The fracture crater and the undersurface of the fragment is debrided using a shaver, any burr, to create biology for healing. Then a suture passing device is used to pass a number 1 ethylon through the fibers of the ACL, skirting the bone. The two ends of the number 1 ethylon is then secured and parked in the high anteromedial portal. This number 1 ethylon is used to shuttle a number 2 gauge fiber wire through the substance of the ACL, and this fiber is labeled as thread number 1. Following this, a tip aiming ACL jig is used to drill 4 wires in relation to the fracture crater. One wire is drilled posterolateral, one is drilled posteromedial, the third wire is drilled anteromedial, and the fourth wire is drilled anterolateral in the fracture crater from the 2 centimeter external incision. This is the external picture of the wire, and this is the internal picture of the 4 wires in relation to the fracture crater. Each of these wires are then overdrilled using a 3.5 mm endoscopic reamer. And then 4 suture shuttles are passed into the joint. All these 4 suture shuttles are of different colors to help in suture management, and these suture shuttles are secured in the high anteromedial portal. These 4 suture shuttles are then used to shuttle thread number 2, 3, and 4 in a pattern shown in the animation to create a suture bridge kind of configuration, as you will see. This suture bridge configuration nicely compresses the fracture fragment against its crater. The sutures are tied over a bone bridge over the anteromedial skin incision. And once fixation is done, we realize we get full extension, no impingement, and very stable fixation. So this is the final suture bridge construct. There are 4 threads which hold the entire fracture fragment against the fracture crater. A long knee brace is given to the patients that kept non-weight bearing for about 4 to 6 weeks. Active knee range is started immediately from the very next day. Full weight bearing with knee brace is started after 4 weeks, and without knee brace by 2 months. Sports, running, jumping is allowed after 6 months. So if you see results, 12 patients were included, 9 were male, and the mean age was 25. The youngest patient in my age group was 14 years old. All of them had some kind of twisting knee injury. 10 patients were managed acutely. 2 patients had delayed presentations of 2 years and 32 weeks post-injury. At the time of presentation, all these patients had pain and some kind of swelling. Clinical examination, tender was there along the medial lateral joint line, and Latchman was positive in all these patients. Radiology-wise, 1 patient had a type 2 fracture, 7 patients had a type 3, and 4 patients had a type 4 fracture. MRI was done in all to assess the status of the ACL and to see for any associated intra-articular injuries, and 2 patients had meniscal injury. 1 had a lateral meniscus and 1 had a medial meniscal injury. So this is a case study of a 35 male having a type 3 ACL tibial bony avulsion. You can see the immediate post-operative X-ray, seeing the position of the bony tunnels. Most of the cases, I could manage a suture bridge configuration. However, whenever 1 or 2 tunnels would converge, I would have to use an endo button to tie the knots on the tibia. Full range of motion is achieved by about 2 months post-operatively. As you can see, the wounds heal up beautifully. Fracture union is achieved by 2 months. At 3 months follow-up, the mean Lisholm score reaches 88, which improves to 98 by 6 months. At latest follow-up, which is about 10 to 12 months, all patients were satisfied with respect to pain, range of motion, and stability, and had resumed their previous level of activities. Immobilization fails to reduce the displaced type of ACL tibial bony avulsions, and if not treated well, will lead to non-union, which causes laxity, and malunion, which leads to anterior impingement. Arthroscopy is the best technique, I feel, because it produces minimal fat pad and retropatellar tendon space scarring. You can assess the status of the ACL ligament. Very accurate reduction can be done under magnified vision and illumination. The intermeniscal ligament and any loose body can be taken care of, and any associated chondral meniscal pathologies can be taken care of. I do not prefer using screws because there are comminuted bony fragment and a fractured crater. K wires give you insecure fixation and can migrate. Staples can back out. The reason of this is there is a fractured bone bed. Future imaging is affected and future knee surgeries implants can come in our way. Sutures give the example advantage of surface hold, no fragment drilling, secure cortical fixation. However, the problem was moment you tighten it, it causes anterior elevation, which can cause impingement and anterior displacement of the fragment. So the suture bridge technique, thread number 2 and 3 causes strong compression of the fragment against the fracture crater. Thread number 1 prevents any anterior translation and thread number 4 prevents any anterior elevation. And totally, it gives very secure fixation of the fracture. Drawback was obviously to the small patient at that time when 2017 it was published. The youngest patient I operated was 14 years old. I would not recommend this in children with open physis because the volume of the knee is also small. These would be my references. And interestingly, you could see article number 2, published by Dr. Sundararajan and Rajasekharan way back in 2011, is one of the references in this article. So to conclude, I would say that the suture bridge pullout technique is effective method of fixing this ACL tibial bony avulsions with respect to pain, motion range, and resumption of pre-injury activity level. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mihir. Very nice, informative lecture, nice technique. Now I'll request Dr. Sundararajan, since his paper is quoted here, to ask questions.
Mihir, congratulations for the wonderful technique.
Thank you.
Sir, I agree that I was using staple at the time in the initial stages. Then slowly we are moving into the suture pullout technique. And also I compared we did a randomized study on the staples versus the suture pullout technique. Even the results are both are good. Of course, the complications of staple back out and I had to do a resurgery in few of the cases. Even few on the two cases, even it is migrated to the posterior compartment. So we had a little bit more complication in staple. Definitely the suture pullout technique has changed our lifestyle very easy in doing fixing these fixations. Can I ask one question, Mihil?
Yes, please.
I believe that because US configuration is more on that on the side, did you see to see any patients have a fixed flexion deformity? Because when you have bring the wires on the either side of the fragment, not in the front of the fragment, may resulting in elevation of the fragment at the anterior end of the pull. So that may can cause some fibrosis and sometimes restriction of the extension. So what is your results of
it? Sir, if you see, I'm using 4 sutures.
Yeah.
And suture number 4 goes from the anteromedial to the anterolateral tunnel. And it prevents the anterior elevation, which usually occurs when we tighten the sutures. So that avoids any future impingement because of a malunion.
Yeah.
What is, you have the portals, entry portals at the level of the posterior rim of the ACL, right? In line, two portals, right? What is the role of that?
You mean the posterolateral and posteromedial tunnels?
Yes.
Yeah. So what happens when we use a single suture and we tighten it, you have to understand the trajectory of drilling is from anterior to posterior, no matter what suture configuration you use. So moment you start tightening, the posterior of suture always has a tendency to pull the bony fragment anterior. And many times you would see in your lateral X-ray that the anterior edge of the ACL bony fragment is actually anterior to the tibial rim. So the posterior thread, that is thread number 1, which goes through the substance of the ACL, prevents this anterior migration. And it is at the level of the mid-ACL substance. So I don't go right up to the posterior cortex. So if you measure the distance from the PCL to the intermeniscal ligament, the posterolateral and posteromedial tunnels are made midway. And it directly compresses the fragment down without allowing any anterior translation.
In your method, do you have anything to compress the anterior most part of the stump?
Yes. So the fourth suture, which I label as thread number 4, is is from the anteromedial tunnel to the anterolateral tunnel. And both these tunnels are made in relation to the anterior horns of the medial lateral meniscus, basically at the region where the meniscus comes into the intermeniscal ligament. So this thread doesn't allow the anterior elevation of the fragment.
All right. They don't go in the ligament. They don't bite in the ligament at all. For this,
the ACL, yes, thread number one goes through the substance of the ACL.
The last one, number four.
No. It is on the surface of the anterior aspect of the fragment.
Because the other day there was a webinar of IAS which showed the new technique as the medial lateral, no, when he had already done it earlier.
Okay.
Okay, Raju. Shirish?
Yeah, I have a question. Yes, or rather, please. See, we all do. I use either a arthroscopic 4 mm CC screw fixation or pull out, but I don't use 4 tunnels. I use 2 tunnel and do similar sort of configuration. But what I found is if fragment is robust and fixable with a screw, I always get bias to do a screw fixation because the fixation stability and compression, what you get with the screw is unbeatable. If it is a comminuted fragment, yes, pull out suture fixation is good treatment. What I found, if you go wrong in the placement and precision of tunnels when you do pull out suture, sometimes the reduction may not be as anatomical as you have shown. You have to be very careful on the placement. If you're too much inside the bone bed, the suture itself comes in your way of reduction. If you are too much on the cartilage, you tend to damage the cartilage more. So I think if you're utilizing this technique, you have to be very precise on your, rather a screw fixation in a robust becomes a very, you know, straightforward case where you just put in a screw and you come out.
So the reason, Shirish, I started using these 4 sutures was I realized that on the X-ray, what you see is not actually the case. So, in fact, the classification, McEwen and Mekar's classification, type 1, 2, 3, 4 on X-ray, usually they turn out to be type 3, type 4 when you go in the joint. And this technique let me fix any kind of configuration of the fracture back into its place. So it was like, you know, a solution for all kind of fractures. Secondly, I don't need to reduce it preoperative. I don't need to reduce it before I drill the tunnels because the tunnels are drilled in the crater. And these are all 2-gauge fibers. So even if it comes in the crater, it lets the fragment go in very nicely the moment you tighten the 4 sutures.
Mihir, well done procedure. I also do like Shirish.
Yes, sir.
With 2 pull-out sutures, but double-stranded suture bridges. But since in your technique, you are cutting the intermeniscal ligament, to place the anteromedial and lateral portal tunnels, you are removing the intermeniscal ligament. Actually, you can use the intermeniscus ligament to reduce the fragment.
I completely agree with you. So when I started and when I published this paper, I would be cutting the intermeniscal ligament because many times what happens is we cannot identify accurately the reduction anterior. But what I have done as a future after this paper is number one, I retract the intermeniscal ligament. As you correctly said, the role of intermeniscal ligament becomes very important. And I've shifted now to using tapes as thread number 2 and 3 because it gives more compression of the fragment against the fracture crater. So yes, there is improvement even after this paper was published. Number of patients have increased and I've changed my technique also. I believe intermeniscal ligament is very important and we should not cut it.
Very good point, Raghu. Swaminandu.
Yes, sir. The problem is that yeah, is well said by Mihir, and I think Raghuveer has also pointed out properly that when you do this, the community of the large fragment is when you try to remove the front and try to see the cutter, most of the time the intermeniscal ligament goes off. You are not being in a position to save this depth thing, otherwise you cannot see the front. Even sometimes you are fat and this soft tissue, whatever is in front, you have to take off. Otherwise, there will be extension at the fracture gap when you tighten the suture. That is the problem. And recently, there are a lot many papers and the things are coming that you don't have to take care of the intermeniscal. Even if you save off that intermeniscal, it doesn't matter. Because it just keeps the meniscal rotation in proper place. Otherwise, you don't have that much fraction because function on that. So you can jolly well take off that intermeniscal ligament. There is no harm.
Okay. Even Robert said that he did not feel there was any role of the intermeniscal ligament, except for, which was not clear what he said.
It is only for the rotation. It is only for the rotation. It doesn't give anything extra. Even I just, this is as because a lot many people are listening to it. So we must be very, very confirmed say in saying that even if you save up the intrameniscal ligament, it is not going to do any harm. You confidently take that off.
I sir, I agree with you because I feel the primary aim of this surgery is to get accurate reduction. And usually this intermeniscal ligament with the retropatellar fat doesn't let us see, because we are viewing from anterior portal and we need to see antero inferiorly and gets sometimes difficult. However, I mean, as much as we can preserve, we should preserve. But many times, if I cannot get the anatomy, I will definitely excise the intermeniscal ligament.
So last maybe word from last word from Nicholas sir. Nicholas sir, on
maybe you can use the transligamentous portal to retract that to see it well and then do this.
Right, sir.
Point very and, well taken, sir. Last question I want to ask is, Mir, how was your oldest one?
My oldest one was 45 years old, presented at 1.5 year old.
All right. Now tell us, give us the experience of this case. Okay. Because it's not going to be easy. That is a big fragment, small fragment, and why you decided instead of not doing a direct ACL reconstruction.
Okay, so why I decided for fixation, because I believe that no collagen, artificial or natural, can replace the ACL collagen. So if there is bone, I will always attempt it to fix it back. Secondly, preoperatively, I had a feeling that I may not get reduction. However, I realized the reduction was very easy. The only issue that I had to do was I had to remove the fibrous tissue from the crater. And in doing that, I could not get perfect anatomic edge to edge or, you know, spike into spike reduction, because the fractures had rounded off. So what I did was I deepened the crater to remove the fibrous tissue. And then I used the four tunnels, and the moment I tighten it just falls back into place. This was the only one patient which had pain even post-operatively at the latest follow-up. However, he was stable, he is doing all his activities, got his knee range back. So the myth that we feel that all these bony avulsions, be it ECL or ACL, we may not be able to get reduction at when they come to us delayed, I feel is wrong. The reduction is easy. The only thing is we have to create biology well, because there was tremendous. In fact, when I lifted the fragment up, I thought there was cartilage which grew over there. You understand? So we have to really go and debride it with a shaver and a scoop to open the cancellous bone. That was the only issue which I thought was.
Yeah. Nicholas, sir, I've got a final question to you, so that you are the headmaster today in this forum. So I've got the final answer from you. Is there any scope of screw, cannulated screw, for the ACL avulsion?
You're asking me?
Yes, because you are the boss here today, you and okay. Raju.
Yes, of course, there is that if the fragment is big enough, strong enough, you can always put a screw and fix it up. It's not that.
But problem, we have seen so many disasters with the screws. I am really nowadays, because I have been a bit old, grown old, so that I have been seeing so many complications on that. So that's why I'm asking you and Raju whether you have seen the complications with the screws. Because unless it's a big chunk and a type 2-3 sort of thing, it is not big. No hidden combination is there. Sometimes during the screw also it becomes, sometimes the screw can screw you.
Perfectly right. While screwing, you can screw the bone piece also.
That is the problem.
And that's why one must keep the other technique in at hand and try and do with that technique, you know.
Okay. So last time when you did the screws, tell me the truth. Tell me your thing. Screw for the ACL avulsion.
Yes, I remember that very well. I tried to do that. I thought I was accurate in my this, but then finally it was not. And patient had a long time to get better. I don't know whether that case has come to you.
No. Unless these long distance trains are coming in this lockdown period, is not going to come from Maharashtra to West Bengal. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Raju.
Raju, you have to unmute. Raju, please unmute yourself.
I am saying thank you, everyone. Now we must close this because it's 2 hours.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, Raju. Thank you, all
thank
the speakers.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sandeep.
It is absolutely on time. It is from 6 to 8. Yeah. No problem.
So, dear viewers, we have very interesting webinar coming up tomorrow. That's webinar number 42. It is the first Indian Arthroscopy Society and SARC Arthroscopy meet. I would like to request Dr. Samantha to tell about this.
Yes, because we have been planning for this SARC meeting because it was supposed to be done in Bhutan this year in the month of May. So some registration has also been done. But because of this pending, we had to cancel this because no way it is possible even in near future. So this was our plan. So I think the whole IAS team, our president, then Sundar, and specifically Rajiv Raman, who is taking care of this invitees and all the faculties from the neighboring countries. Like even you can see the Afghanistan one faculty is coming, Bangladesh is coming, Sri Lanka is coming. Then Nepal is coming. So we are going to have this is a good interaction and platform. So even we'll continue this sort of meetings in near future from the IAS.
So stay tuned tomorrow at 7 p.m.
Please join and tell as many as your friends so that we can reach maximum people throughout the country. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think IAS has to be congratulated for this initiative.
Yes. Special congratulations to two big guns in this IAS. Those are Rajiv Raman and Sandeep Bilaris. And wow. Ranjit, because these are the few guys, are the futures of the IAS. So they are doing
good.
Okay, I think
we'll end this meeting, sir.
Congratulate all the faculties. Thank you.